The Unsung War Casualties,
Chapter 4. As the days and nights passed, we were wearing down and getting closer to the end of all endurance. The guards, too, were simply being stressed beyond their endurance for their age. One guard, on my right, began having difficulty walking. His feet were slowly getting frozen like ours, and he was about 66 years old and in poor health. I could see that he was having trouble, and I was sorry for him. He might not last as long as we might. None of us had bright futures. Now, Sax and my dad, Wright and Rapetti, were probably about 21, 22, 23 years old at this time. They're almost like these guards could be their fathers. In some cases, maybe even their grandfathers. It's just that's how big of an age difference there was. I don't know why, but it seemed natural. Between towns and when officers or outriders were not in sight, I began to carry his rifle for him. He didn't object when I reached for it, and when he saw that I was helping, he said, "Danke." Of course, I returned the rifle whenever we passed through towns or his superiors were near. That word "Danke" means thank you. After a while, he said, "Mi nix postan, mi fader." Rough translation, "I am not your guard. I am your father, figuratively speaking." So, there is such a human element involved, even though these are, quote, bitter enemies at the time. When they went through these struggles together, it was a bonding experience, almost at times like a father-son experience. Continuing, "We were crawling with lice, that is, Wright, Southerton, Saxton, I should say, and Saxton, Rapetti, always swore that he had no lice and guessed that he was immune to them. We didn't believe that, but it didn't matter anyway. The pain in our frozen feet was almost unbearable, and we were starving. We looked to each other like bearded skeletons by this time." What a description. We looked to each other like bearded skeletons. "Days and weeks passed without sleep, and we often closed our eyes and dozed off while walking. Bumping into those around us kept us going in the right direction." Listen to this description. "Sometimes I pretended I could withdraw from my feet and legs into my head to avoid the pain. I made believe that I was inside my head only and looking out through my eyes as if they were windows." Sully and the others, I think, were doing the same. By the hour now, the Russian artillery grew closer, and at night, the sky behind us was lit up by exploding shells, rockets, and flares. Polish and German civilians began to crowd into the roadway and became intermixed with the prisoners. We were all fleeing toward the west. Soon, there were hundreds of thousands of refugees trying to escape the Russian advance. They spread over the landscape for half a mile on either side of the road, carrying their most precious possessions. Soon, they were becoming exhausted, and one by one, their treasures were being abandoned in the roadway and all over the fields. There were beautiful sets of silver, clocks, silver-mounted shotguns, chests of drawers and clothing, all priceless possessions being dumped to lighten the load. In one town, a German hospital emptied into the endless mob of escaping humanity. Nurses were pushing patients along the road in their hospital beds in a hopeless effort to stay ahead of the Russians. They were falling behind one by one and soon would be taken by the Russians and probably killed. Late in February 1945, the Russian tanks appeared on a road parallel to ours and began firing across the fields into our column. Artillery shells from behind also began to rip into this fleeing mass of humanity then, suddenly, Yak fighters swooped down to strafe our column. They came back over and over and dumped bombs and rockets into our midst. Panic set in, and the Germans lost all control. They were throwing down weapons and running like the rest of us. The four of us, Sully, Rep, Wright, and me, stayed together and ran off into the woods to our left. We found a depression in the ground and lay there as motionless as possible until the fighter planes ran out of ammo and took off to the east. So I want to show you a picture of one of these YAK fighters. Wow, look at that. And they would be Soviet Union planes, Russian planes. Just incredible fighting machines, and knowing that they were above would certainly strike fear in anyone on the ground. Continuing, when we got back to the road, it was strewn with dead and wounded people. Prisoners, guards, civilians, and absolute chaos prevailed. We debated waiting for the Russians in hopes that they would be friendly, but a rumor that the Russians were hostile to Americans convinced us to scurry. So we just joined the fleeing mob of terrified humanity, running to the west. As the mixed column of prisoners, civilians, and German soldiers bore down on each town, the shop windows were broken, and people helped themselves to bread, cheese, wine, and anything else they could grab. We tried to avoid those places, as we were afraid we would be shot if any of the German SS or Nazis saw us there. All the while, the Russians were throwing shells at us from the side and behind. The four of us got a bit ahead of the main part of the fleeing multitude, and we came to a town where there was a big hotel and restaurant. There was a semi-enclosed area beside the restaurant where people, civilians, were eating at tables. We just strolled in and sat at a table. A waiter came over, and we were trying to order something to eat. It was unreal. The waiter was preparing to bring us something when Russian army artillery zeroed in on the hotel. Shells crashed into the sides of the building above our heads, and we, and the waiter, were suddenly back on the road, running for our lives. The hotel patrons joined us in our flight. It was like the scene from Dante's Inferno. Dead bodies of men, women, and children, dead horses, dead soldiers, and we, the living, running through it by the thousands. It was a scene like Exodus, only with slaughter beyond description. Half the population of Poland and Eastern Germany was on the move and running for dear life. We were just specks in a sea of running souls. None of our guards were to be seen again. They were running like everyone else. Many others were dead. We didn't know what else to do except keep going toward the west in hope of finding the American lines. Two more pictures before we close out this chapter. Oh my, look at the destruction from the bombing. This, I believe, is a picture where, I don't know if it's a picture of England, I don't know if it's a picture of Berlin, or which is in Germany, but you can see the destruction that's there. Let's see if I can pull up one more, just an example of what it was like after the planes had gone through and dropped those bombs. So again, you can see that destruction. We will continue with Chapter 5 coming up with our next video clip.